So I come from the KEM hospital, and I tell very proudly this is the only diabetes unit in the world which has mother and baby as the logo. Dr. Seshia stressed about the fetus being the important one, and we have that message since 1980s when I started this. There is a new logo which we have acquired, and that's this modern Ganesh. And you can see that Ganesh, by tradition, is overweight and obese. He used to travel on that small mouse, which you can see there. That's now very cross, because the modern Ganesh clicks the mice. And he clicks many mice. And that has added to the problem. And this is the rapid transition we had in India. I actually collaborate with Medical Council Research Unit in the UK. And that was because of David Barker, who came and met me in 1991, changed my career, made me start investigating the fetal origins of adult disease. As a diabetologist, this is what I learned, that diabetes or type 2 diabetes has a genetic predisposition, and then there are precipitating factors, which are predominantly obesogenic, whether it's diet, physical inactivity, stress, or whatever. The genetic susceptibility we consider as non-modifiable, and therefore we concentrate on the precipitating factors. This has led to a big diabetes prevention program in the US, and their motto is eat less and walk more, which we all try to do. That they have claimed causes primary prevention of diabetes, which I don't agree. And I'll show you at the end of it that if Indian women, 70% of them are there in the village, if they ate less and walked more, what might happen to the diabetes epidemic? This is the average person who entered the diabetes prevention program in the US. He was on average 51 year old. His body mass index was 34, so he was obese. And he had to have either impaired glucose tolerance or elevated glucose. These are three end stage conditions: being old, being obese, and being high glucose. And then we zapped them with actually a beautiful physiotherapist who contacted them three times a week to control their diet and activity. We ensured that they lost 7% of their body weight, and we claimed a 60% reduction in progression to diabetes. You can imagine at 51 years of average age, very few of them were in the reproductive age. So none of that benefit went to the next generation, and whatever harm they were to pass on had already been passed on. So it was probably a wrong intervention at wrong time for the betterment of the mankind rather than that person. And this is the basis which you must keep in mind. As obstetricians, you are in a unique position, and we'll see how. This is a summary of what I have done over 25 years, my unit has done. We started in 1987 with the Welcome Diabetes study. The latest study we have started is epigenetic imprinting in a gestationally diabetic pregnancy. And in between, we have investigated the increased susceptibility of Indians to diabetes. Dr. Seshia told you about increasing diabetes epidemic. We are the world's leaders in this. And my effort has been in search of modifiable susceptibility. Genetic susceptibility, we said, is non-modifiable. Is there something modifiable and susceptibility so that you don't have to struggle with the precipitating factors? And then there are better changes, or better possibilities, chances, that other conditions might also be prevented if environment changed. I started with these, facing these two paradoxes, and that's how my research has been driven. First one was when I was training in the BJ Medical College in Sassoon Hospital in 1970s. And we used to read the Western textbooks, which described type 2 diabetes as occurring in the grossly obese people. The average patient in the Sassoon Hospital was not obese. He was in fact thin. And that gave me an idea that a condition which occurs in the obese in the non-Indians might be occurring in the non-obese in the Indians. So when I went to UK for my training in 1981, the simplest thing I could do was to compare the clinical characteristics of about 200 patients in our clinic and 200 patients in the UK clinic. It happened to be Oxford that time. And we made very simple observations, which are still with us today. The first one was that we showed that Indians get diabetes or get diagnosed as diabetic at least 10 years younger. And that gap has now increased. Now you're seeing a lot of gestational diabetes, and these girls are in their 20s. In the Western world, usually the diabetes is diagnosed after 45 or 50. Second thing was the average Indian patient, BMI was at least 5 units short, smaller. The BMI in the Sassoon clinic was 23.5, as opposed to Oxford clinic, which is 28.5. We looked at mid-arm circumference, which is easy to measure with a tape, gives you an indication of muscle mass. And we found Indians had at least 20% lower muscle mass. So they were younger, they were thinner. But if you looked at them sideways, and you can look at your patient sideways, or patient can look in the mirror, and you will find the telltale sign in the middle. That's what we call either paunch or the central obesity. Despite being younger and thinner, Indian patients had at least 5% higher waist to hip ratio. They had a higher subscapular to tricep skin fold measurement. For this, you need a skin caliper, and we had done it. Subscapular is a central fat, triceps is a peripheral fat. So we have higher subscapular to tricep skin fold ratio, indicating we have a higher central fat deposition. Later on, when I got money to measure body fat, we measured body fat and showed that for each indicator of obesity, whether it's body weight or BMI, Indians have 30% higher body fat percent. And this is where I started advocating that we should dissociate our idea of obesity from adiposity. Indians may not be obese, but they are very adipose. The percentage body fat is much higher than the Westerners. And this in turn reflects in their insulin resistance, so that an average Indian is 1.5 times more insulin resistant than an average Caucasian. This, of course, was met with a lot of resistance. People don't like simple measurements. They want something done in a black box. You have to buy an expensive instrument and convince them. So then we actually had a very interesting experience. That's my friend John Yudkin and myself. John Yudkin was professor of medicine in UCL, University College London. We designed a study to measure body fat in Indians, and we measured body fat by 5 different techniques to get these techniques sort of sorted out. And the important decision we made was the principal investigators should undergo the same tests which you expect the participants to undergo, which means we measured our body fat. Now that's John Yudkin, that's me 20 years ago. You will have to believe I was young at one time. And I went into the black box, and I called this picture costing me £39,000. That was the cost of the DEXA machine in 1999. So surprisingly, we made some interesting observations. not known to John, not known to me, we had identical BMI. So that if you look at BMI of these two gentlemen, it was identical, 22.3. I hadn't put on weight, John hadn't lost weight to get us there, it just happened. But the DEXA machine showed something very different. John's body fat percent was 9%. In 1999, I was 21%. So for same BMI, I had more than twice the body fat percent as an Englishman. There's a very interesting story at the bottom, which was the requirement of the editor of Lancet to sell this idea. You can read it. I'm not going to read it. It's in Lancet 2004. But this convinced people. In fact, today this is one of the most frequently shown pictures in diabetes and obesity meetings. Just to say that BMI between different populations has a very different meaning. The second paradox was this Indian paradox that India is the capital of two. These graphs are called cartograms. Some of you might have seen them. They are on the website called worldmapper.org. So you can look at the cartogram of diabetes in the world and you will find India is a very fat country. That's because we have a lot of diabetic patients, current estimate 71 million. Doesn't matter, it's a lot of numbers. And then you flip through the pages of this website to see whether India is fatter for any other condition. And surprisingly, it's for undernutrition in early life. India is even fatter than the diabetes graph for undernutrition in early life, and which you face every day in the form of low birth weight. Today, between 25 to 30% of pregnancies in India are still low birth weight. If you put against intergrowth, 70 to 80% of our babies may be SGA. So our babies are born small. They remain small till 5 years of age, which is the definition for undernutrition. And at the same time, we are the world's capital of diabetes, which we consider an overnutrition disease. This paradox had haunted me for a long time, till the time it was solved by David Barker. This was the paper David published in 1991, around the time he came to see me. And what he showed in Hertfordshire, where he traced people backwards for their birth weight and found a cohort of people where birth weights were made and recorded. And he studied over 400 of them at an average age of 65 years. And what he showed was that there was a beautiful inverse association between birth weight and risk of diabetes or syndrome X, which is what we called at that time, now we call metabolic syndrome. So that lower the birth weight, higher the risk of diabetes or metabolic syndrome in later years of life. And he called it thrifty phenotype hypothesis, which he said type 2 diabetes is the outcome of fetus and early infant having to be nutritionally thrifty. So the fetus had to make arrangements to the structure and function because of poor nutrition, which in turn reflected in increased risk of diabetes in later life. So then everyone said this must be genetic, because that's what we do when in exam people ask, teachers ask me something about something, first thing I used to say genetic, which used to satisfy him or her. It used to give me time to think about it so that I came with real things. So what isn't? I mean, we all start our life as a bag of chromosomes, and then environment acts on it, and then we develop as an individual. So everything has a genetic basis. It has to be, because that's how we begin. But whether that changes your approach to the condition, does it allow you to prevent it, does it allow you to treat it, is the real question. So that is told to us by how the genes work. And this picture, which was given to me by David Barker, is a Yorkshire horse and a Shetland pony. Shetland, you know, are the islands in the north of Great Britain, very harsh conditions, and the ponies there are quite small. So 1936, Walter and Hammond, two veterinarian surgeons, mated a Yorkshire horse, which you can see is tall, with a Shetland pony. And what do you think actually the offspring was like? This is a picture of father and daughter. So the offspring was more like mother. So it was the uterine or intrauterine environment which influenced the phenotype of the baby at birth. And that's a very famous picture. And then came the Dutch famine story. You perhaps know that in the last 6 months of the Second World War, Germans cut off the food supply to Western Holland. So everyone lived on a ration of 600 calories per day. So the pregnant women also had to eat that ration. And their children have been followed up. And a whole specialty developed around this. What it shows in this figure is the risk of obesity in people who were in utero at the time of Dutch winter hunger. And what it showed was that if that child was in utero in the first two trimesters of pregnancy, he had higher risk of being obese later on. If that child was in utero in the third trimester, that child was at a lower risk of obesity. And the possible explanation as early as 1976, when I read this paper as a registrar in medicine in New England Journal, they said in third trimester, the adipocyte number is decided. So if you are undernourished, there is less obesity because you have less adipocyte number. And in the first trimesters, when the brain is developing, if your brain is hungry during development, it tries to make up in later life and then you tend to become obese. So brain programming versus adipocyte programming in different trimesters. And this led to the concept of plasticity and programming. Plasticity is a phenomenon where if a developing system, like say an embryo, is provided enough of everything, it takes the path of its genetic potential. It achieves what it is supposed to do. In conditions which are not ideal, it has to modify. It has to choose a pathway which will first place let it survive and then develop. And that's called programming. It alters the structure and function to suit the surrounding environment. The signatures remain with you for the rest of the life. When situation changes, it creates trouble. And there are various issues about it. We won't go into detail, but just remember that an intrauterine adversity is a stimulus for fetal programming, which might become detrimental in later life. And today we think this is based on epigenetics. Your genes are same, but they express differently if the nutrition is different. There are three known mechanisms today. I'm sure there are many more. DNA methylation is one of them, miRNAs, and histone changes, either acetylation or phosphorylation. And these studies are very actively in progress. So I told David Barker that if I actually find what you are saying in Indians, then I'll join you in this research. So we set up the first study, which we called Pune Children's Study in 1991, and studied four-year-old children born in my hospital. We could get their birth weights from the labor room. We did a glucose tolerance test and showed that there was an inverse association between birth weight and glucose and insulin concentrations, indicating that those who were born low birth weight had higher glucose, higher insulin as early as 4 years of age. That convinced me, and therefore I started investigating this. We followed these children at 8 years of age again and showed that those who were born the smallest but had grown biggest at 8 years, so born small but grown big, had higher risk of all the non-cardiovascular risk factors. They were more adipose, they were more centrally obese, they had higher cholesterol, they had higher blood pressure, everything. And you tell me, what do you do when you give birth, or your patient gives a birth to a low birth weight baby? The parents, the doctors, and everyone goes after them to make them normal, to make them big, because we consider small as a problem. And that might lead to this situation. So there is a postnatal element to this. And there is a societal element to this, because I'm not going to speak much about gestational diabetes, which is another programming event, like Dr. Sesha explained. But I'm just going to tell you that in a rapidly developing country, where a Ganesh changes from sitting on the mouse to clicking mouse, what's happening? So that in, like, say, undernutrition circle, we are producing thin babies, which also happen to be fat, as I will show you. They remain insulin resistant. But if they grow in villages, in the more natural conditions, they are less at a risk of getting the problem. They move to the cities, or they are born to the overweight or diabetic mothers. They are big from beginning, and they tend to get more diabetes. And that is how the association between birth weight and diabetes, we now know, is U-shaped rather than only an inverse one. And as the world is progressing, we are increasing the other arm of the U more and more. So we set up this study, which is now quite well known as PMNS, Pune Maternal Nutrition Study, in 6 villages near Pune in 1993. And we screened over 2,500 women who were married but not pregnant, followed them every month. 800 plus became pregnant. They were intensively studied in pregnancy. They gave birth to 770 normal singleton pregnant babies. And we have followed them up every 6 months till 18 years. And every 6 years, we have done intensive cardiometabolic risk studies, body composition studies, neurocognitive measurements, a whole lot of things. And you will see that our follow-up rates are more than 95%. So that we can account for practically every baby. We have made lots of observations on this. I'm not going to get into details, but I'm going to tell you some of the major ones. The women on average were 42 kg with a BMI of 18 to start the pregnancy. Their babies were 2.7 kg, which is our national average, but they had higher adiposity even than a 3.5 kg English baby, which is shown here. So the Indian baby, which looks small and thin, had a higher skin folds when compared to the English baby. And later on, I did a study with Imperial College Nina Modi and did whole body MRI in 30 babies born in Pune, 30 babies born in London. And we showed that on whole body MRI, the Indian babies had higher abdominal fat inside as well as outside, despite being 800 grams smaller. We showed that the cord blood had higher levels of all the risk factors for future diabetes: high leptin, high insulin, low adiponectin. We could not find an association with maternal macronutrient intake, but with foods which are high in micronutrients, like green leafy vegetables, fruit, and milk. And because of my interest, when we measured B12, folate, homocysteine, we showed that low B12 in mother and high homocysteine predicted IUGR, which in turn we know is a risk factor for future diabetes. And then we have followed up these children. As I said, now they're 18, 20 year old. We found that low maternal B12 in pregnancy coupled with high folate in pregnancy was associated with increased risk of diabetes in the baby. If mother had low B12 and high folate, these babies were more adipose, more insulin resistant. These babies became more adipose again at 18 years of age. And in a separate study, which is one of the world's biggest, that's quite surprising to me also, of neural tube defects. We had 4 centers in India, and we studied 350 neural tube defects, 750 controls, and what we showed was that in our study, B12 deficiency in the mother was the major risk factor for neural tube defects. And a polymorphism in a B12 controlling gene called TCN2 in the mother predicted the increased risk of neural tube defects. And finally, we have done many neurocognitive studies where we showed maternal B12 folate influences brain development. So ultimately we decided it was all boiling down to so-called one carbon metabolism. I'm not going to go into it, but it's a very detailed metabolic cycles which control DNA synthesis, DNA repair, methylation, and a whole lot of other processes. So it's at the center of fetal growth, and B12 folate are related to controlling it. They actually influence one carbon metabolism and therefore possibly a whole lot of things related to genetic and epigenetic mechanisms. Now, why should we have low B12 and high folate? At least partly it's because of vegetarianism. So unlike the Westerners, we are multi-generationally vegetarian. It started 2500 years ago when Samrat Ashok won the Battle of Kalinga and became Buddha's disciple. So Buddha preached him about Ahimsa, so he stopped killing animals for food. And then the vegetarianism developed. 3 religions preach it. And in a study we found, in a very interesting study we found in Pune, that higher education, higher income, and better hygiene predisposes you to B12 deficiency. So that urban middle class are more at risk of B12 deficiency than urban slum dwellers. And the reason for this, can you think about it? Is because B12 in nature is made only by microbes. So if you try to keep microbes away from you and you are a vegetarian, then you are at increased risk of B12 deficiency. And we now have very strong proof of this in our cohort, where B12 deficiency has increased over 20 years with improving education and hygiene in the villages. On the folate side, it's opposite way around. Because folate comes from vegetarian food, higher food intake and a better socioeconomic status means better folate status. Then the government program provides iron and folic acid to adolescents and pregnant women. And as obstetricians, you cannot not prescribe folic acid because that's what you have been programmed to do. You have been told folic acid prevents neural tube defects. Then someone wrote on 12 patients it prevents PIH, etc., etc. Now, what is the preventive dose of folic acid to prevent neural tube defects? And when do you need to start it? How much? We need to start much before conception, so it has to be started preconceptionally. And what's the dose? 400 micrograms. Now, Folvite is the commonest tablet you use, is that correct? How many milligrams does it contain? 5. 5 milligrams is how many micrograms? 5,000. Very good, you are very informed. Now that means 12 times higher the recommended dose. This came about because the dose for prevention of recurrent NTD is 4 milligrams. And the only trial in India which was done by ICMR, which was stopped in the middle because of ethics reasons, used 4 milligrams. And everyone has forgotten that it was a trial for recurrent NTDs. And the tablet is 5 milligrams. We are taught as medical students, B-complex vitamins are water soluble. They will come out into the urine. So you can prescribe. So many of my friends prescribe up to 3 tablets a day. I was walking in the corridor looking at doses of folic acid in various preparations, and they range from 1 milligram to 5 milligram, and surprisingly B12 also up to 1500 micrograms. We are grossly overstuffing, grossly. And an imbalance in a vegetarian population between low B12 and high folate is partly iatrogenic because of our obsession with folic acid. So you can now start thinking, I might have actually disturbed your days. So as you said, we need to start before conception. Why do we need to start before conception? Because before the woman knows she's pregnant, a whole lot of things have happened. Starting with gametogenesis, fertilization, implantation, embryogenesis, placentation, etc., various processes. If you start your folic acid or B12 after she comes to you with diagnosed pregnancy, you have missed all these opportunities. That means it's a public health rather than a doctor-driven thing. And we need to think about it. But that's why we need to do trials from before pregnancy. And that's what I started in 2012 in Pune. We call it Pune Intervention Study, PRIA. It's a rural intervention in young adolescents. And we went by the philosophy, which is given by a Danish philosopher. He said, life can best be understood backwards, but it has to be lived forwards. So based on our research, we found out something, and now we are trying to live forwards. And that trial has now enrolled 557 adolescents from our cohort for intervention with either B12 alone, B12 with multi-micronutrients and milk powder to provide 5 grams of protein a day, or a placebo. Everyone gets the Government of India recommended iron and folic acid tablets. And we started in 2012. First delivery happened in June 2013, and up till now 80 deliveries have happened. Very surprisingly and rewardingly, girls are now marrying later. So today we had expected 200 deliveries to happen, but only 80 have happened because girls are educating. In the mothers, 1/3 were illiterate. In today's 300 plus girls, only 6 haven't completed 10 years education. All others are beyond 10 years. So that's a very rewarding change, but that has actually asked me to postpone the trial. So instead of 3 years, we are now going to intervene for 5 years. And we are going to look at various fetal outcomes, either in the short term, in the cord blood, but most importantly, as we follow them. First time in the world now, we are doing an intervention in adolescents, boys and girls both, where we are going to study F2 generation, but we have detailed serial information from F1 and F0. So we are going to be able to do a lot of complicated analysis. And friends from across the country are going to help me do what we call multi-omics. So we will look at DNA, we will look at RNA, we will look at proteome, we will look at metabolome, whole lot of things. So very expensive and nice studies are going to happen. So I'm going to now summarize for you what I have said is that we are talking of a life course evolution of a phenotype. For you, the phenotype may be infertility. For me, the phenotype may be diabetes. We as doctors want to treat patients, and therefore we have to depend on the extreme phenotypes. The real things happen much before, starting with the genome, but importantly, epigenome, which allows you a modifiable susceptibility to tackle. Then through childhood, a whole lot of changes happen. Then through adolescence, and finally in adult age, we call something as disorder or disease. And if we don't look backwards, we miss perhaps the most important points. Now you can imagine if the 42 kg, 18.1 BMI mother in Vadu, where we studied, ate less and walked more, her babies would have been even less than the 2.7 kg. to me that would have exaggerated the risk of diabetes even further. And therefore, we have to contextualize the advices for different populations. So I'm going to stop here by telling you that actually so many people are involved in this over the last 25 years, many trainers across the world, many collaborators in India, above all the participants in the trial, and our funding has come from international sources, the Wellcome Trust, the MRC, from DBT India, ICMR, EU, all lots of things. So thank you very much.